Hey.
All right. We are live. Facebook works. Good morning, everybody. I am privileged to be here with the one and only Robin Johnson and the one and only Jeff Cohen. My name is Eddie Levine, and we are here to talk to you today about the recent changes that have happened with Amazon, specifically related to Fulfillment by Amazon, FBA, that were announced yesterday. Before we jump into that, let's just give a quick, like, 10-second intro on who you are in case we have any new people joining us. So, Robin, go.
So my name is Robin Johnson, Best from the Nest and Marketplace Blueprint. So we have an agency that helps brands, and then we also have a coaching company and consulting company that helps resellers.
Hi, Jeff Cohen from Jeff Cohen. I don't know. People don't know me. Seller Labs. Been in the e-commerce space since like 2012, something like that. And we work with tens of thousands of sellers on the Amazon platform with Feedback Genius, Ignite, and all of our other tools.
And again, my name is Eddie Levine. I am the president, co-founder of HubDub and Wholesale Breakthrough. We help sellers of all levels, as well as manage brands on multiple e-commerce platforms. So jumping into the news of yesterday, as Robin and Jeff, both of you obviously know, Amazon had a kind of a shocking announcement earlier in the morning stating that because of the COVID-19 coronavirus, whatever you want to call it, they are now limiting the types of products.
Sorry, that I am the president and co-founder of HubDub.
Okay, I've been, oh, hold on. I had a little background noise. Okay, let's try again. So Amazon had that notice about that they're only allowing certain products to be sent into the Amazon FBA channel, including products such as household goods, masks, medicine, grocery type items, basically anything that you could identify as being essential goods for dealing with this particular virus. So there's a bit of a gray area. Obviously, I would think, in my personal opinion, it would take a lot of time for Amazon to go ASIN by ASIN and look at each individual item and then approve them. So what are your general thoughts on the whole issue that has evolved in the last 24 hours?
So I think that Amazon has, so we all know that Amazon, first and foremost, is going to protect their brand name, and they have to protect the customer experience. So if people find, hey, Amazon isn't reliable, hey, Amazon isn't there for me in a crisis, this is a huge opportunity for them to get market share. And so they need to make sure that people are having positive customer experiences. And I think that they're, what they're doing is they're saying, hey, instead of taking in a bunch of garlic presses that aren't going to sell for a while, let's focus on making sure that the things that people really need, the things people are relying on us for. So it's an inconvenience, but I think it's overall to protect the platform and to protect the customers.
Yeah, I mean, listen, if my garlic press breaks, I'm going to need to buy a new one. So I think Amazon has to balance the everything store and having some things in the store, but also having the stuff that people need. If it hasn't hit your community yet, it's probably going to hit your community in the next day or so, where they're going to shut down restaurants. I think that's pretty much rolling throughout the whole country by now. And as people are having more and more trouble, shopping in a store, they're going to go online. It's just, it's a natural reaction to move online.
So here's my take on it. I understand why Amazon did this, obviously because of what's going on. However, I feel like in my personal opinion, there's certain things they could have done better, right? Amazon, I feel like, seems to forget that although they're big, if you remove half of the inventory, in other words, the sellers that are supplying the marketplace, right, they're going to have a big problem. And the reason I bring that up is because when they're telling sellers, hey, you can only send in these certain categories or certain products for FBA and for the next 3 weeks, sellers obviously weren't prepared for that, number one. Number two, a lot of sellers are not able to shift automatically to Fulfillment by Merchant or FBM. And they're not set up for that. They don't have a warehouse that can handle that. The people, insert reason here. But also the other issue is here, if the sellers aren't able to send an inventory to FBA and they're not able to sell inventory and they sell out, they rely on that for their business and their income. So if they're not able to receive that income, it has a potential devastating effect on the business. And I think the fear is that hopefully this doesn't last more than they're saying to April 5th, but we don't know because this situation is very fluid, obviously. So, it potentially has big consequences, not only for sellers and brands alike, but everyone that relies on Amazon and Amazon as a whole. So I feel like Amazon, I think, should have come out and said, hey, we're doing this, but we're also incentivizing sellers with X, Y, or Z. We're cutting fees. We're offering free this. We're offering this. I didn't see that. And that's I guess the problem I had.
So go ahead, Jeff. And then I want to play devil's advocate too.
Yeah, I was going to maybe a little bit of that. But I think that when it comes down to it, one, we are all reacting and reacting quickly and reacting in a way that we believe is in the best interest. And I also think that just from a parenting perspective of how I've dealt with the virus, it literally has changed with my kids on a daily basis. So one day I'm telling them something they can do is okay. The next day I'm telling them I don't want them to do that. And so I think we have to put that into perspective when we think about Amazon and the reaction that they're taking, that they're trying to take an action that's best for everybody, and people are going to get hurt in the meantime. I think that this is just, I'll call it like a further wake-up call to building a business that can withstand the change that comes from Amazon. Because when we talked, I know you, Eddie, you and I have talked about this before. It's not about what the next change will be from Amazon. It's when the next change will come. Mm-hmm. And so this is just the next change that you have to be able to roll with as a business owner to ensure that your business can survive whatever is going on. And so what you should be doing potentially now, if you have inventory that's not at Amazon, then you should be looking at how you can start setting up merchant fulfilled. You've got, you know, a certain amount of inventory at Amazon until that runs out. You can get merchant fulfilled set up. You have time to be thinking about that. I would warn people, assume this is going to happen longer than we think. The yeah. same thing I said to my wife with grocery shopping. This isn't about 2 weeks of restaurants being closed. This is about in two weeks, restaurants might be closed to takeout. So how do we prepare for that? How do you prepare for the next thing to happen longer than what you're expecting it to happen? Because if you're just like, okay, I can wait 3 weeks and in 3 weeks I'll send in my inventory, there's a good chance that in 3 weeks they extend it for another 3 weeks. And I also think that there's a challenge because there's products that could be very popular that aren't considered a necessity. But like I took my kids I took my kids a few days ago to Michael's to pick up some like arts and crafts supplies. So they had some other activities to do around the house. If I need more of those type of activities, I'm going to go online to get those in the future. I'm not going to go back to the store to get them. So,
but that's just the thing, right? There's different levels of necessities. You have level one necessity, which is basically what they outlined on their blast yesterday. But then you have level two, three, four, however you want to go, which could include those toys and games that are going to keep kids busy, right?
Yeah, they're just not staffed up for this. I mean, they're talking Q4 type of volumes, and they're not staffed up for it.
Yeah. So Robin, you had a point. Sorry.
Yeah. So, you know, I think that you're right. Amazon could have cut fees. They could have done something to help sellers. But remember, Amazon is not on our side. They use us in a way that would not be appropriate in most other relationships, right? But that's what we've signed up for. Now, you know, there's a lot of people saying like, you know, posting like, you know, if you want non-essential goods, come get them on Amazon because they're going to be all sold out. Now, if this continues to happen out for a long period of time, we're going to see a couple shifts happening. We're going to see people merchant fulfilling. Yes, the prices will go up on items because merchant fulfilling it usually is more expensive. But also remember, there was a huge decrease in demand for non-essential goods. So many people that are like literally entire industries of people have no paycheck and have no paycheck for the foreseeable future. So the number of potential purchases that we have. So let's say you had 4 to 6 weeks in stock, which I think all of us have been recommending since as long as we've been talking on webinars, right? So if you have 4 to 6 weeks of stock before March 9th or whatever, right? And then now they've done this now, your 4 to 6 weeks of stock has probably turned into 6 to 12 weeks of stock. So yes, it will impact supply and demand, but the demand has shrunk at the same time. And also Amazon's looking at, okay, how can we make customers at least happy? I ordered some batteries for my kid's train because it's the world's first worldiest problem that their Lego train doesn't have Legos to run right now. And so they're like, why is it taking so long? But they understood that there's a crisis. And so their AAA batteries that were Amazon Basic. And this is kind of goes to it. I ordered those batteries Sunday morning. They are still not here on Wednesday. So if somebody was relying on Amazon to deliver that children's Tylenol, then that creates a really negative experience. And they don't want to be in the press with people saying, you know, Amazon is falling apart and you can't trust Amazon to get your goods. So you have to understand that there's some things that Amazon does to protect the platform, and they're always going to prioritize that. You know, when you sell on Amazon and Amazon is your primary source of income, you have one really bad poop crazy customer, and your job is to keep that customer happy. And so we have to look at, what does our customer Amazon, because they've made it very clear that the customers are not our customers, what do we have to do to keep our customer happy and to still be net needed and necessary by that one crazy customer? So what are Amazon needs going to be, and what can we do to make Amazon look good? Because resellers have not made Amazon look amazing in the last week.
I thought we weren't going there. Eddie, can I turn something around on you? Not turn around on you, but I want to flip a question back to ask you, because I think this is more your forte than it really is mine.
Yeah.
I'm a seller. Yeah. I've got inventory in a warehouse, and I want to start setting up merchant fulfilled because I believe this is going to occur for a longer period of time. Yep. What are the first things I should be thinking about? Because I think that, like, in my mind, sellers need to be thinking about not when am I going to get my inventory to Amazon, but what am I going to do if I can't get my inventory to Amazon? So how do you solve that? How do you solve that problem, which is an easier problem to solve than like spinning up a Shopify store, right?
Right. So this is one of the points that I was gonna kind of follow up Robin's comments with, and this is something that all sellers should be thinking of, whether or not you're doing fulfillment by merchant right now to begin with, right? So doing FBM, one of the biggest drawbacks of that, unless you're seller fulfilled Prime enabled, is you don't have that Prime badge, right? So then sellers or buyers are going to wait a longer period of time to receive. They're not going to see the Prime offer. They might pay for shipping, etc. The thing you have to remember though is right now Amazon is not meeting their Prime deadlines anyway. Everything's delayed. So that's kind of an equilibrium there, right? The other thing is, with regards to being Prime eligible, remember that the demand for things in general, not all categories, but in general online, it has soared because people don't want to go into stores that are closed, they don't have stock, et cetera. So odds are a lot of products are going to be greatly reduced in terms of the amount of sellers that are offering those products if they have multiple. So your fulfillment by merchant offer most likely will have a lot more visibility than it would in general, right? Now, from a warehousing perspective, to go back to your question specifically, if you have a warehouse or you have the ability to ship from your location, that's great. Or if you don't and you cannot set that up at all, then you should be working with a 3PL or someone who can do it for you, who you can potentially partner with in this during this time to get that enabled, right? But you need to consider things like your fees, for example, on Amazon. Everyone's used to the FBA fees, and you're used to what that costs you to fulfill through Amazon. Well, fulfilling through yourself or through a 3PL adds a whole bunch of complexity to it. There's different fees involved. There's shipping is different. There's time frame differences in terms of when you need to submit an order versus when they can get it out. There's requirements from Amazon of when you have to ship it out. There's staffing issues you have to think about. You know, if you're one that to have, you know, only 20, 30 orders a day, that's obviously easier to manage than someone who has 500,000, 2,000 orders a day, right? That's a whole different story. So, and then you have to figure out, okay, do I have the logistics capability of getting stuff to the carrier? Can they pick up from me? Which carriers am I using? There's a lot. I mean, we could have a whole hour discussion on that, but I think the thing that I would really take away from that question is the fact that FBM, if you can manage to do it or partner with someone who can do it for you, can help you, is not necessarily as big of a drawback right now as it has been throughout history.
Yeah, it's a good safety net to spend some time this week setting up.
And just remember, for every listing, every ASIN that you have being sold to the platform, you're eligible to have an FBA offer and an FBM offer. So you can, in theory, put an FBM offer up as a safety net, like you said, and leave your FBA offer active. Get the stock in there as soon as you can once this is lifted, or if it's in transit now, you can use this time to do FBM while it's being checked in or in transit to the facility, because they said that stuff would still be, processed as normal. So do both if you have to, if you're able to.
Well, and, you know, way back when, you know, some of us were here when FBA first came on the market, you know, when there weren't as many FBA offers, merchant fulfilled sold at a good clip. So we kind of assume, especially if you came in like the last 5 years, that merchant fulfilled just doesn't sell. Merchant fulfilled listings and offers don't sell when there's an alternate FBA offer. Right. When there's no alternate FBA offer, they move because people do want them. So, and those goods, they would rather have a merchant fulfilled offer on Amazon, many customers, rather than somebody's independent Shopify store that they don't even know is legitimate. So, you know, there is benefits there. And the other thing is, you know, before you list anything merchant fulfilled, just a quick warning, make sure you have those shipping supplies before you make it available. You do not want to be in a position where you have a bunch of items to ship and you do not have the goods to package those things in. And, you know, I would say limit the amount of offers that you have in the beginning, because if you get overwhelmed and you destroy your late shipping metrics, you are toast. You are done. Wrap things up. You are over. So you need to be really judicious in the way that you roll this out. So start testing now. Find some SKUs that already don't have the offers and start there.
That's a really good point. So I want to bring back to an issue that I personally faced in December of last year during the holiday season. So there's a couple of SKUs of mine that we were not eligible to do. Well, we were eligible. We could have done FBA with them, but because they fall under the hazmat category, they obviously go to a different FBA facility. So the shipping and logistics to get to FBA takes longer. They have to go on a separate shipment, et cetera. So what we did is we put them up on Fulfillment by Merchant for a while until that FBA offer was activated. And so we as a business are not as set up for FBM, although we can do it. It's not our bread and butter model. So it's always an interesting transition when we have to like ramp that up in a really relatively quick period of time. But in December, there was one day of the entire month that we happened to miss the deadline for, I think it was 12 shipments that we had that day that had to go out that day. We missed it. So we were late. And we noticed it the next day and we shipped it out and we upgraded the shipping method so that in theory, the delivery still made the required time frame, which is we just shipped it late, but it still got there delivered at our expense. So we did that. Our metrics bounced up a little bit in terms of, you know, late shipment rate, but it was still under the 4% metric right now. So we were under that. But then the problem is they look at a trailing 30-day and a trailing, I think it's 7-day or 10-day. They look at both metrics. So the problem is because that was kind of at the tail end of our FBM shipping volume for the season, what happened was when all of the good shipments fell off, and then all we were left with was those late shipments, our rates soared. So we were into the 20, 30, 40% for late shipment rate. So Amazon was, of course, you know, giving us all this bad information saying, you know, this is not good for your account. You know, your account's at risk for deactivation. So that was stressful, right? But you have to remember that Amazon is unforgiving when it comes to customers and expectations. And obviously Amazon is not meeting the expectations that they have that they state for sellers themselves right now with Prime, but Amazon, as we know, is a very do as I say, not as I do platform. So, you know, just keep in mind that if you're going to transition, like you said, Robin, to FBM, you have to have those checks and balances in place first. You have to really know your ability and your time frame and make sure you have the staff and the supplies needed to execute on this effectively.
Okay, let's reach out to some of our guests. You guys, if you are out in the audience, got a lot of people watching, appreciate you saying hi. Any questions? You guys got any questions or any points you guys want to make? Go ahead and make them in the comments. So Robin loves love. I mean, she's a hugger, and I know it's killing her right now that she can't be hugging everybody because she would be preparing to load up her car and take her whole family with her to Vegas to start preparing for her week-long adventures at ASD and Prosper and everything else. So Robin needs love. So to make Robin feel the hugs, you gotta hit the heart button for Robin. Because I know you're a hugger. And and then, you know, we'll start answering some questions you guys have. And see, I think one of the questions, Robin, I was gonna ask you was you had said earlier, like, what can, you know, Amazon's doing all this to protect the platform. Do you think Amazon will, you know, this might impact people's inventory performance index. Their sell, if I had a product, I'm just making this up. If I'm selling a stapler, my volume of staplers might drop dramatically Whereas if I'm selling toilet paper, they've increased dramatically, right? Go look at the search terms. You know, do you think Amazon's going to make some adjustments to those type of things so that sellers don't get dinged?
So in general, if you're looking for Amazon to be compassionate because there's a pandemic, you should go someplace else because they're not. You are late shipping. If your metrics fall, if any of those things happen, they are going to be just as hard as you on you as they would have a couple of months ago. Now, remember, when it comes to IPI, the big potential pitfall of a low IPI is that they limit your storage. So if you already if you're specializing in goods that are not selling as well, that storage decrease is not going to impact you as heavily as it would have, you know, a couple months ago, because one, if your items are not moving, where are you going to get that other inventory money to buy enough inventory to fill up that limited amount of storage? Anywho, right? So you can stress. So when I'm a worst case scenario person, and it makes Nate crazy because I was like, okay, so well, how much would it take for the banking system? I need to go, how far can it possibly go to get that bad? And then you need to think, okay, so if that was to happen, how would I combat that? And you know, it's like they say people with anxiety do really well in situations like this because we're already really used to like worst case scenarios and dealing with that. So that's kind of the coping mechanism. I would say, okay, so if this doesn't happen, what would I do to combat that? Would that really affect me? Or am I focusing my worry on the wrong places? Because I think where people really need to be focused right now is cash flow, cash flow, cash flow. Your number one priority right now, above everything, outside of keeping your family safe, is to make sure one, you have enough cash to keep your four walls up and running, and two, to make sure you have as much cash as possible that when this is over, and it will be over, this too shall pass, that you have enough money to take advantage of the opportunities. After the Spanish flu came the roaring 20s. There are opportunities coming, and you need to preserve our cash flow, make good, you know, thought through decisions so that we have the ability to bounce back up when this is passed.
So I'll tell you that for us as a business personally, you know, one of the categories that the majority of the products within that category are still able to be sent in is the grocery category. And I said from the onset of this pandemic that I would not entertain the thought of selling masks or any kind of like water, any kind of like those top five products that people would need during this pandemic. I just didn't want to go there, especially like hand sanitizer, things like that, because Amazon was getting really, really strict with that. But in terms of like the grocery category where you have thousands and thousands and thousands of items, that I felt was a safer bet because there's so many of them. That's not the entire world is looking for one specific thing, right? So from a grocery category perspective, from our suppliers and our brands that we work with on that side, we're doubling down on that stock right now because A, it can be sold, and B, it's in high demand, and C, it helps with that cash flow that you're talking about.
Okay, so somebody asked a question about getting inventory for FBA or for FBM, and Rich, we agree, bubble fast. Mark, if you're online, great chance for you to throw out a link and a coupon for everybody. I know I just threw you under the bus and had you do a coupon. Otherwise, Eddie will text you and tell you to get online quickly. I think this is a great question for you, and I think the next one's probably a good one for me. And I think it's something a lot of people are thinking about. What are you hearing regarding, you know, the massive disruption that would come, which would be a shutdown of UPS, FedEx, USPS?
Yeah. So this has been a concern of mine, not just this week when they announced this issue, but just throughout the issue. But I've been in constant contact with all of our carriers and our drivers who come to this facility all the time, asking them, hey, what are you hearing? What's happening? Are you guys changing any schedules? Or is staffing down? What have you? And so far, it's normal, knock on wood. That being said, if we have a nationwide shutdown and things are mandated here and there, that can obviously change in the blink of an eye. Is it possible? I suppose it's possible, but it's not really something that I feel that you can prepare for if the logistics company shut down. I mean, there's just no way to do it. You know, I mean, I would say that the best way you can prepare for something like this is to really just diversify your options in terms of shipping. So if you're only a postal carrier shipper right now, for example, diversify and open up your options to UPS and FedEx. And if vice versa, if you're only UPS, look at the other options so that if one changes their operational procedures or they can't, you know, meet your expectations, you have other options. Again, you can't really avoid this if multiple carriers shut down or if the government shuts down this as a whole, but you know, you've got to do the best you can.
And I also think one of the things to think about, whether it's your carrier, whether it's the guy delivering your package to your home, whether it's the guy who's picking it up from your office, whether it's the restaurant you're picking up from takeout, you know, think about what little extra you can do for them. And you know, my wife's a physician. She still has to go into the hospital. There are people who you know, are still putting themselves out there to keep life moving for everybody else. So keep that in your mind, you know, and keep them in your thoughts, in your prayers. Think of ways that you can just kind of make their day a little bit better for the extra effort they're putting in, and keep that, you know, keep that all going.
I'd also throw in just as a quick point that outside of a nationwide shutdown where it impacts everybody, if a carrier like UPS or FedEx were to shut down, you have to remember also that Amazon has spent a significant amount of time and money developing their own logistics network. So my prediction would be if there's a phased shutdown or change on this kind of logistics operation, my theory would be that you would see the bigger companies change first and Amazon would react last or try to preserve as much as possible because of their network that they built out.
And let's just face it, if trucks stop moving, if freight stops moving in this country, Amazon is going to be the last of our worries. So, you know, let's not borrow trouble because that kind of trouble we can't fix. So,
certain things that are beyond our control.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So Dennis was asking, do we turn off PPC? I think I have a couple answers on that. I'm sure Robin, I know you manage a lot of PPC and Eddie, you do too. Mm-hmm. I think that, I want to get a new shirt that says "It depends," because
Tyler's line. You can't steal Tyler's line,
right? No, it's really Brett's line when he talks about Amazon advertising and you know, with all of our clients that we manage, like it really depends. So if your product is a product that's selling, like you should keep advertising. It's very common in times of downturn that the first thing you do is stop advertising, and it's been proven in history that the companies who advertise during down periods come out of those periods stronger and faster. So now put the asterisk next to that. And if your product is slowing in general and your cost of ACOS is starting to soar, then I would start to scale back your advertising. So I would maybe be a little bit more diligent in how I'm managing advertising. I might be checking my goals to ensure that I'm managing them to the right goals and the right profitability, but just turning it off completely is going to impact you in so many other additional ways that you might hurt your business more than you think you're helping it. You know, I'd be willing to offer, it probably hasn't happened long enough for me to have enough data to offer an analysis of what's happening specifically from the virus and your advertising, but because you need data in Amazon, and if you're looking at a 30-day time period, it's too wide, and a 7-day time period probably isn't enough data. So I'd say that, you know, start keeping an eye on your data. If you want to reach out to me, LinkedIn, Facebook, I'd be happy to ask for a 60-day bulk upload file, and I can run an analysis and send you a report and show you what I see in your advertising. That's something that's easy for us to do. We do it for our clients all the time. But I don't think that just pulling the plug on something makes sense unless you have a more strategic understanding of what that pulling of the plug does.
What about taking products and changing up and adding certain keywords or targets that you wouldn't normally have? For example, toys that you have that maybe you want to add a keyword that's more geared towards homeschooling or things like that that would be relevant when kids are at home. Would you advise on that, or would it be like, nah, not worth it?
So Amazon in general has this is where it's like uncharted territory, right? So Amazon in general has said, don't change your title related to Prime Day or to the holidays. But I do think that as you're looking for alternative uses of your product, or as you're identifying alternative uses of your product, it's a great way to be doing it. Think about other ways to market and promote your product and what you do. I mean, with everyone doing homeschooling right now, there are a ton of people who are posting different things online. I watched the penguins running loose in the Shedd Aquarium yesterday. I watched Mo Willems drawing from his piggy book to the kids. I watched Josh Grad reading a book to kids. Like, there's other ways to market what you're doing and what your product is besides Amazon. There's ways to give back into this world while people are hurting. And just, you know, don't be thinking about the mighty dollar and the sale, but think about the greater, you know, world and what's happening and how you can, you know, have an impact in that.
Right.
You know, with seasonal keywords, it's everything on Amazon is supply and demand. So you always want to be looking from that lens of supply and demand. So if you are the only one person in your category has thought to add that, then yes, then that might provide you some lift because you might get some sales from that. However, the more people do that, remember, it's not just about does a keyword have traffic? It's does that keyword have traffic, and is it realistic for me to rank for that? So if you are going to kind of say, I'm going to try to rank my Lego thing for homeschooling, then you need to be, kind of look and say, okay, am I just going to try to change some backend search terms, or am I going to spend some PPC to actually focus on actually ranking for that and follow like a keyword ranking strategy? And like Jeff said, with advertising, there's a halo effect. When you're running advertising, you get that affects the sell-through rate of all of your products all the products that you're advertising, not all of your products. So you need to consider a couple of things. You need to think about cash flow and the existing market demand and competition. So is the item that you're trying to advertise, is that market share consistently moving? Is the term moving? If so, then it makes sense to advertise and maybe even increase your advertising to make sure that you continue to rank on the first page in those first couple slots for really important keywords so that you can make sure that you're gathering as much cash, as much sell through, as much brand awareness and brand adoption during this period as you can. So if you're selling something like maybe you sell airplane pillows, then maybe you're going to pull out your advertising and you say, look, you know, we're going to have a cash flow issue going forward. Realistically, we're not going to get good ACOS. We're not going to get good sales right now because people aren't traveling and there's only so many uses for an airline pillow. So what we're going to do is we're going to pull back on that, focus on diverting into different inventory strategies or different product mixes. We're going to look at maybe different business opportunities. We're going to do something to diversify and to kind of save that cash. If you sell something so we have a couple of spice companies that with and those companies are having better than Q4 days, like sometimes two times better than Q4 days. So it makes sense for them to continue, and many of them have increased their ad spend because they want to make sure that they continue to rank on the first page. So like Jeff said, it depends, and you need to be thinking about all of those things. But if you're looking at, you know, what should I do? Should I add this keyword? You want to always be looking at it like, what is the likelihood of me being able to rank for that? And how much am I willing to spend in order to have that happen? Because you can always do it. It's just how much is it going to cost you? And what is the benefit, the potential profit and revenue benefit of doing those items, of those action items?
All right. So Eddie, I got a question for you that comes up. Often, this comes up often, and I believe this fits right under navigating Amazon FBA with the coronavirus. Okay,
yep.
I can't ship my products in; they don't meet the criteria. I'm forecasted to run out of stock. Do I raise my price? Do I run my stock out? Do I pause my product? Like, what do I do? What do I do as I get up to running out of stock? And then what do I do once I run out of stock?
Okay, so I'm going to take your answer and do it depends on the product, right? Personally, in my opinion, I seldom raise my price points on my products to correlate with market demand, simply because a lot of my products, even if I raise the price point, if I was low on stock and if I was going to run out of stock, I'd run out of stock regardless if I sold it at X price or Y price. And my issue is not necessarily just trying to benefit and raise my price and make a lot of money on the short term, but my issue is the product and the ASIN and the reviews on the long term. More and more often, I'm finding that I get reviews that are negative if the product is grossly overpriced. So what I want to try to avoid on my products is the ones I sell is negative customer feedback stating that, hey, this is just a ripoff, it's not worth this price point, which they might just even leave later after this whole situation has evolved. They won't maybe leave it right away. but that's going to impact you long term. So like at the end of the day, I'm looking at it and saying, was that extra $10 worth it, right? And so maybe I stayed in stock an extra 3 days, but was it worth it? Because now I have potentially these bad reviews and bad feedback that are going to make it more difficult to sell my product for even the regular price point later on. So again, it depends on the product. Different categories will have different things you can do with them. But in general, for the stuff that I sell, I don't usually raise my price. Obviously, I follow market conditions if necessary. But for products that I'm, for example, the only seller and that I'm managing exclusively, especially if they have a target MSRP for a brand that we represent, we're typically just keeping as it is if we don't want to create a negative brand image.
Robin, how are you kind of advising your clients on that?
Kind of the same thing. So if you need to watch, and then so if you can avoid a stock out, that's always going to help you, right? So just the same thing that we would always recommend. Like if you look like you're heading into a stock out, and then we're going to look at potentially pulling back PPC, pulling back coupons. Those are going to be the first things, right? Then the next thing we're going to look at is maybe increasing the price, something along those lines. Now, something that I think we should kind of gently talk about is, you need to be careful if your good could be considered essential, that you don't increase the price more than 10%. That's the gouging law in California. That would be the standard that I would recommend that you follow. So it would be 10% of your price. A lot of people are talking about like, oh, well, I only had a 40% ROI. They don't care what your ROI is. They care what the price was. So if the price was $10 on March 9th, when the state of emergency, I think that was when the state of emergency was done. So whatever date of the state of emergency was declared, if it was $10 then, you can only sell it for 20% more, right? So you can only sell it for $12 then. And that would be the entire time while the state of emergency is happening. Now, the next question is, well, is my good essential? Now, there are, because you could argue that certain things are or not essential. Just to kind of keep yourself out of the press, out of public scrutiny, out of maybe creating yourself as a potential target for kind of prosecution, I would look at it from the customer's perspective, saying if I'm stressed out, I'm looking to control an uncontrollable situation. I'm just desperately trying to keep my family safe and to feel like maybe I can do something to stop this and to keep my family safe. When I'm looking at that empty shelf, am I going to say that item was essential to me being able to protect, feed, clothe my family? Yep. And don't go at like, well, do you need it to survive and arguing these little, look at it from the customer's perspective. And then all the rest of it will kind of take care of itself.
So there's a question. I'm going to see if I can pose it here. I think people can.
Ooh, yours is fancy.
I just noticed I can do this.
So, you're trying to get favor with Heller.
Heller's a good guy. But here, this is a valid point, right? So it talks about inventory levels, right? And let's look at this from a pre-COVID-19 stance for a second. Amazon before this had changed Prime recently from 2 day to 1 day, right? So that required that they be in stock at pretty much every location possible to meet that new Prime. That Prime promise to buyers, right? So what that meant is they wanted more of your inventory to be spread out over all warehouses that required you to send more inventory in. So I think the point I'm trying to make here is if you are normally sending in, 2 to 3 weeks of inventory, 4 weeks of inventory at a time, if that's your normal replenishment, at a time like this, when we have this issue that has been announced yesterday and potentially we'll have either this extended or issues down the road if this gets worse, which hopefully doesn't, but it's possible. If you're doing 3 to 4 weeks of inventory now, think about boosting that up, making normal inventory 5, 6, 7, 8 weeks of inventory, not only for this issue, but for the fact that Amazon is trying to get products to customers very quickly. And the more products you have available for Amazon, don't obviously overstock to where it's just sitting around, but the more products you have, the ability for Amazon to spread that over the entire country and get those products to your customers at a quick pace is greater. So that's it's an important thing to think about when you're trying to forecast your numbers for what you're going to send into Amazon.
And all the forecasting numbers, one thing, big mistake that you could make was assuming because I sold X in the last couple, over the last 7 years, I'm going to sell the X again. No matter what you sell, whether it's essential, non-essential, in-demand, low-demand, those forecasting numbers are not going to be reliable for the foreseeable future. So you need to you can't just take what Forecastly or Restock Pro is telling you. You need to look at it with some common sense and make some adjustments and really taking into account your cash position when you're restocking these orders.
Yep. So okay. we... So- We got about 5 minutes. Do we want to take a few more questions or do you have another?
Yeah, point? I think this is a good one. It came up a couple of times. I saw it coming through the comments about retail arbitrage and like, should people be seeing this as an opportunity to be doing grocery retail arbitrage? Do we want to touch that?
I'll touch it. Okay, so
maybe start with read the paper.
So, you know, if you are doing any kind of RA where you're taking essential goods, and I consider food an essential good because I don't know about you, but my kids get super cranky when they don't have food. So Eddie gets super cranky if you, you know, so you're taking that item out of that local space and putting it into a marketplace. Now, when you do that, it takes it out of the marketplace altogether for a while. So let's say I buy a bunch of Tylenol, children's Tylenol, because I know children's Tylenol will probably, you know, it probably could sell for a good multiple. I would consider essential good. I wouldn't mark it up, but that's a whole other story. Let's say I take that out of the marketplace. I ship it that day to Amazon. And let's pretend we could still send shipments to Amazon. Oh, we can't for that. But so it takes 2 weeks to get checked in. It takes 3 days to get bought. And then it takes another 5 days. So I've taken that Tylenol that could be used today to help somebody out of the marketplace for 2 to 3 weeks. So let's leave those things there. And also, can I just like, as I implore, I love so many people in this community. Maybe I'm a worrywart, but I do not think it is safe to be sending shoppers or you or your family out there to stores right now. It is, this is serious. So, and then the next question is, you know, the natural thing, well, can I do OA then? Just remember that one of the problems that people had with OA in the past was by the time they bought it, got it sent in, the price had completely diminished. If you think about every RA person you know going to OA, that's going to get a lot worse and you're going to tie up a lot of cash. So yes, there are going to be some people who do it well, make a lot of money, but you know, can you withstand that if you're not one of those people that ends up winning? And yeah. I know the person who posted in there is not saying that he was doing it. So, and I am not attacking anyone. I'm just saying, like, for the love of everything holy, please stop.
Yeah, I think I follow Robin. I think I follow what Scotty Walker said at his hashtag stay the F home. Like, you know, I think you're trying to take advantage of a situation. You're putting yourself at risk. You're putting others at risk by being out there, and you're taking away from people who are going to that store looking for things. And it's like, this is kind of like the, you know, this is like the issue where, you know, the people in Chicago couldn't stay home from the bars on St. Patrick's Day. So the governor went and closed all the bars. So it's like, if we don't take, this is personal opinion, if we don't take our own personal responsibility and do things that are going to help reduce this and flatten the curve. And if you haven't read any articles on flatten the curve, I highly recommend it, because that's ultimately what you're trying to do. None of this is about stopping the virus. It's about flattening the curve. And anything that you do that's not working to flatten the curve is working against the greater good of what we're all trying, of what everybody should be trying to do. And it's not about judging. It's just about us working together so that we can not put others at risk. I mean, that's what it comes down to. It's not about, will it make me sick or is it worse than the flu or anything like that? It's about the risk that you put on other people. And I think that if you're taking food out of the supply chain for any period of number of days, you're putting people at risk. If you have, you know, let's think about how to use your powers for good. And maybe you reach out to some food manufacturers that don't have an online presence. And this is a great time to say, do you want me to help you? Like think of working in that type of way, as opposed to thinking in a way of taking it from the shelf where people are putting themselves at risk to try to buy it.
So I want to end with this question. This is one that Peter posted a while ago. And it says, do you believe this is a good call to action for retailers to quickly pivot up to other channels to sell through, you know, Shopify, your other platform, your own store, et cetera. So my take on this would be, absolutely, this is a great reason why you should be looking at other marketplaces, not just third-party marketplaces, but also possibly your own site like Shopify, like Peter says. But don't wait for the next pause in I don't know what to call it, the best way to call it, but pause in what they'll accept at FBA to take this step. You should be diversifying your business every single day of the week and every single time you get up to operate, right? Because diversifying your bit, I just touched my face. I keep doing that on this call, and it's annoying me, but I keep doing it. But you should be doing that every single day, because it's how you grow a healthy business, right? If you have multiple streams of income from different channels and different platforms, then it's not essentially telling yourself that you're going to be, you know, immune to a potential issue that's going around like we're facing this country. But if you're a seller who's only relying on Amazon FBA, for example, that's your only bread and butter system, well, when something like this happens, it's likely going to cause you a tremendous amount of problems versus someone who has 3, 4, 5 other channels going at the same time and can get some other income to support what they're missing.
So with kind of to add on what Eddie said, there's a couple things I think that we should be doing going forward, and diversifying is definitely one of those. But you want to make sure that you're looking at, like, what's the potential revenue, and if everything went the way that I wanted it to go, and let's say I kicked up Poshmark and all of that, would that still be enough to cover my cash flow, my bills, or do I need to be looking at alternate ways to make cash? So we need to be looking at it from first step is to really know what you need in order to survive and to go from there. One quick second, if I could just high horse for one more second. If you're sitting on essential goods like face masks, hand sanitizer, Lysol wipes, especially face masks, I've seen a couple people in the community say, well, I'm just going to sit on them until I can make a better profit off of them. Please don't. Please get, you know, liquidate. And let's just put this, let's take out the humanity issue of maybe people might potentially die because you're sitting on these items. But let's put it from another perspective. You're going to need that cash in order to be able to continue to run your business and keep your business afloat. Now is the time to look at what inventory you can get, not like fire sale liquidate, but you know, what can you turn into liquid cash, because liquidity is really going to be key here. So please consider doing that. So another thing, you know, so you should be listing your items that you already have shipping materials for, that you've already tested your volume through Merchant Fulfilled. You should be updating your cash flow, be really clear on what your break even is and how much revenue you need in order to just survive. This is also a great time to clean your warehouse. Maybe list some things on eBay and Poshmark that you've been looking to do. Go back and try to do reimbursements. And then looking at your inventory health report. Anything aged over 90 days, what can I do? Do I need to dump it? Do I need to destroy it? Do I need to give it to a charity? Do I need to optimize the listing? What do I need to do in order to get that inventory liquid into cash so that we have ability to buy the next opportunities and play in the next opportunities that are coming ahead? And then, you know, once you've done all of that, you know, if you're a super, super achiever, then, you know, call somebody who maybe lives alone and just be a friend. And, you know, maybe if you're a person of faith, call somebody and pray with them. You know, but those are the things, like if you're looking at what should I be doing, those are the things that I would recommend. And if you're doing RA and OA, you need to look at, it's time for you to come to Jesus and say, like, let's look at what am I going to do in order to provide revenue for my family. My recommendation as I'm talking to private coaching clients is assume this is going to happen for 16 weeks. Create your plan, assuming that we're in lockdown for 16 weeks. If it's less than that, that is awesome. If it's more than that, then you'll already have had a pretty substantial plan that you should be able to move forward with.
So I'm gonna put this up on the webinar just as a closing thing that people can take advantage of. So Mark Levine is the owner of Bubble Fast Shipping Supplies. He is a seller himself, has been pretty active in the community for a number of years. He is offering a 17% off sale on everything shipping related up until the end of the month. He's been gracious enough to share this link with everybody. If you can take this from the post up here I put on here, or it's also in the comments of Facebook. If you'd like to take advantage of that, actually, I highly recommend that you take advantage of that, especially if you are going to add or transition over to FBM in the meantime while this FBA situation is going on. So Well, I'll leave this up. Closing comments from either one of you. Well, because we're a little
Let me add two things. One, Eric Heller's texting me because I guess he wants direct access. And he said that deliveries in China were not halted. So I think that's something important to, when we were talking about that before, deliveries in China were not halted. They might have been delayed within some of the really impacted areas, but across the country they were not halted.
I think that would be a tremendous thing if it happened here in terms of it would be a drastic thing. That's the word I was looking for. I think it would be something that I'm not ruling it out completely, but I think it's going to come as a last ditch. Like this is we have no other options but to shut this down.
Yeah. And while this was really focused on Amazon FBA, I know Eddie, you love it. You can follow John Lawson. He's got a whole coronavirus channel where he riffs on this for hours at a time. And he just wants to know, will you smile? Oh, there we go. I think, John, I think it just happened. I think he smiled. All right. That worked. I knew that mentioning you and your channel would get him to smile.
Go ahead.
Robin, what I was going to say to my final point is, Seller Labs, as rolling into this as a leadership team for Seller Labs, we looked at it and we started out with what can we do to tighten our belt? What can we do to put our employees first, right? So we started canceling on shows before shows started canceling. We started implementing a service of letting people work remotely and be home. We started implementing procedures by which we can still run our business in a way that will still provide our customers with the level of service that they've come to expect when they work with us. And so those are the kind of things that you need to be doing when you're looking at your Amazon FBA business, is looking at, how are you going to come through this and be a winner at the end? And, great times like this cause you to have to challenge yourself, your business, your practices, and to make very difficult decisions. It might be furloughing some of your employees. It might be laying some employees off. It might be, it might be taking out a small business loan to get over a period of time. And everybody has to make those decisions and have a plan. And the best way to make decisions in your business is to have a plan for what you're trying to do and in what order you're trying to do it, so that you know what your highest priorities are, so that you're not making any knee-jerk reactions. Like for instance, turning off PPC, that's a knee-jerk reaction. You need to have a plan and you need to have metrics that are telling you that it's time to reduce it or eventually turn it off. Not just have a knee-jerk reaction. So your ability to not do knee-jerk reactions, your ability to plan, your ability to seek out advice from others is great ways to get through this. And to your point about reaching out to others, one of the things we have on our kids list every day, they have to reach out on FaceTime to both a family member and to a friend. And so we by our nature are remote workers, and a lot of us know how to socialize, but it's a great point of take that extra effort and reach out to somebody, create the socialization through other means to keep the human connection that is so important to us and our businesses.
Awesome. Awesome. Robin, any last closing comments?
So what I'm doing and what I'm recommending clients do is really be watching. It's very rare in life that you get a crystal ball into the future. And we don't know exactly how things are going to go, but we have an idea. By watching what's going on in China right now, watching what's going on in Italy, places that are significantly ahead of us. So Italy's about 11 days ahead of us. China's about 3 weeks or 3 months ahead of us. So I'm really closely watching those folks that went back to China, back to work in China this last week. In 10 days, I'm going to be really close watching those case numbers to see if they go up. That's going to give me an idea of how long this quarantine would be. And then I would say that, looking at China was able to lock down at a much greater degree than hopefully we would ever be able to, then our time in kind of this social distancing phase will probably be a little bit longer than them. Watch what's going on in Italy. If you're worried about the post office, the power, the water going out, look at what other countries are experiencing. And now there's a variety of countries that are ahead of us. So you can use that to not only provide you a little piece, help you get kind of get an idea of what's going on in the future. And then, like Eddie said, and Jeff said, make sure that you're really staying connected to what's going on in the community. And, you know, just know that there's going to be a lot of frustration and things that aren't, you know, that are going to be difficult for maybe people who haven't been doing this remote working for a while. So, you know, reach out to help them as well. So, and if you need anything from me, please reach out. If I don't answer, it's just that right now, you know, my especially my Facebook messages get really blocked up. So robin@bestfromthenest.com is the best page to reach me. If I don't answer back, just keep coming. You know, give me a couple days in between, but I will get back to you. You know, it just might take me a little bit right now.
So I want to just give my closing thoughts here is that as a business owner, you have a duty and a responsibility to just keep in touch with the people you're working with, your employees, your family, your friends, et cetera, to, you know, just make sure everyone's on the same page. They understand what's going on. You're keeping tabs with how they're doing. Everyone's kind of, there's no surprises coming outside of what you can't control, right? Reassure people, make sure that they're on the same page as you in terms of how you're operating and what your expectations are, and be flexible for people who, when they need certain things at this time of the year, just when things are just so up in the air. So again, if you are doing fulfillment by merchant or want to explore doing that and need shipping supplies, take a look at Mark's post below. That 17% discount is good until the end of March. I want to thank Robin and Jeff. Thank you so much for your time, for jumping on at the last second. We kind of threw this together impromptu yesterday afternoon, and they were so gracious to give up some of their time this morning to talk to all of you. So again, thank you very much for your participation, and for everyone on this webinar who joined us, appreciate you joining in and giving up some of your morning, and hopefully
except Howard.
Except Howard, yeah. Howard's going to be in Vegas for ASD this weekend, apparently.
I mean, seriously, like, is that guy just begging for attention?
All right, guys. Thanks so much for your time today.